So, when Alexander II was assassinated by the people's will, his son took over, Alexander III, in 1881, and he was to be the Tsar of Russia, the Emperor of Russia, for the next 13 years to 1894. Now, often the most common kind of characterization you see of Alexander III compared to his dad is that his dad was liberal and a reformer and known as the Tsar Liberator. And he was considering this great reform on his just when he died at the first national parliament. And then in comes his son, who's completely the opposite, is reactionary, he squashes any kind of political reform that his dad was going to make. And the two of them are quite often, and in quite simple terms, painted as being opposites. And of course, as with everything, the reality is a little bit more complex than that. In many ways, Alexander II was quite reactionary and quite cautious about reform. And after that initial burst of reforms that he had in the first 5, 6 years of his reign as Tsar, he then became quite conservative and quite reactionary. So to just paint the two of them as being complete opposites is a little bit simplistic. And also, in many ways, Alexander III brought in a lot of important reforms to Russia that had, quite profound and significant impacts for the country's future. However, he is known for his political repression. He didn't consider any further political reforms along the lines that his father was considering. There was no extension of the powers of the Zemstvo in the countryside. In fact, there was some scaling back of some of the powers of the Zemstvo. There was no extension of the powers of the provincial, of the municipal or the city Duma. And there was certainly no consideration of a national Duma. Alexander III was a convinced autocrat, and he clung strongly to the principle of autocracy. And in fact, any revolutionary or radical groups that were suspected of trying to foment kind of rebellion against autocracy were treated very harshly, including the hanging of revolutionaries who were involved with the people's will, who had assassinated his father. And the elder brother of a young St. Petersburg up-and-coming lawyer called Vladimir Ulyanov, who later became famous around the world as Lenin. So he's known for political repression. He's also known for economic growth. This is the big feature of Alexander III's reign as Tsar of Russia. The country expanded enormously economically, under the direction principally of three ministers of finance. The first one is a man called Nikolai Bungi. He was involved in expanding the economy of the country, getting more railways built, trying to reduce taxes on the peasants, and also trying to help the peasants be a bit more productive by setting up a thing called the Peasants' Land Bank in 1883. And this was a government-backed bank set up to provide loans to the peasantry so that they could buy more land. And the hope was that if they bought more land, that they could, become more efficient farmers, more enterprising, and grow more food, be more productive, and maybe produce food that could be exported so that would bring foreign income into Russia that could be used for investment in the infrastructure of the country. So this was a fairly major attempt, yet another attempt at addressing the needs of the peasantry that happened under Alexander II. Bungay was followed by another finance minister called Vishnogradsky was his surname. I can't remember his first name off the top of my head. And he carried on much of the same kinds of work, which tried to reduce the tax burden on the peasants and also to increase government intervention in the running of the economy and the growth of railways, especially and famously the Trans-Siberian Railway, the railway that eventually would spread all the way from St. Petersburg, the imperial capital, up in the Gulf of Finland. In the far cold north, what is it, northwestern corner of the Russian Empire, up near Sweden, all the way down to Vladivostok in the far southeastern corner of the empire, bordering Manchuria, near Japan. So that was a big industrial project, and it was carried on by Vishnogradny's successor, who was a man whose name was called Sergei Vita. Sergei Bitter was appointed as Minister of Finance by Alexander III in 1892 or 1893, and he is associated with the so-called Great Spurt of economic growth in Russia in the 1880s and 1890s. And of course, as Russia became more industrialized, that required more of the workforce to move to towns and cities and work in new factories, new industries, and fewer people working in the countryside. And to an extent, you know, you have to look up some figures, but to an extent, Russia did, you know, catch up a little with the industrializing empires of Britain and Germany and France, who they felt that they were in competition with. And, you know, this was a period of change for Russia. It wasn't just a period of kind of reaction and stagnation that Alexander III is often associated with. But one thing that was constant was hardship in the countryside. And one, you know, appalling characteristic of this era is that there was yet another famine in the countryside between 1891 and 1892. So problems of food production were still an ongoing feature for Russia. Alexander III died in 1894 of natural causes, and he was succeeded by his son, Nicholas II, and he'll be the topic of the next film.